So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we discuss 5 questions which are related to finance and economics current affairs, and they can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams, right? So before moving to question number 1 for the session, I would like to ask you guys to do the customary thing. So if you are a new entrant here and you are watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. It can help you to stay in touch with us, and this bell icon, it can help you to get notified regarding every new video that comes up, right? You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll get back to you as soon as possible, right? So are you ready for question number 1 for today? So here is your question number 1, which says Dash compares the value of a stock to the net assets that the company has, whereas Dash compares the value of stock to its growth potential. So very simple question. Let's see what the correct answer is, and the correct option for this question is option E. So option E means PB ratio and PE ratio. So in first, it should be PB ratio. And in the next blank, it is PE ratio. So guys, if we try to understand the meaning of these ratios, so first of all, if we try to learn the full form of it, so it is going to be PB ratio is nothing but price to book value. So what is the meaning of this? See, here, this is a fraction or this is a ratio, right? So to find this ratio, you are putting price of a stock. So there is a company and that company has a share, and you are putting the price of that share as a numerator, and then you find out the book value of company. Now what is this book value? Book value is found out by this equation, which is assets minus liabilities, right? So this is the book value of a company, right? So you find the book value by this formula, and whatever you get as difference, you put it here as a denominator, right? And then you divide the price by the book value, then you get the PB ratio. Now what is this ratio doing, or what is it signifying? It is comparing the price of the share, which is in market, to the book value or to the records of the company, right? So if this ratio is very high, that means that ratio, that particular stock can be overvalued, because the book value, the books of the company or the accounts, does not show that much value that is reflected in the price that is going on in the market. And it means that investors are valuing it too much, right? So there can be possibility that the fundamentals of the company are strong, but still the price is very high as compared to the books of the company, right? So this is book value comparing price of a stock to its net assets. After that, PE ratio, I think we all must be knowing what is PE ratio. It is price to earning ratio. And for earning, we can use earning per share. So basically, here in PE ratio, we are dividing the price of a stock by earning per share of a company, or the money that a particular investor gets on one share, that reward is put into denominator, right? So PE ratio tells you that what price an investor is willing to pay for earning this amount, this EPS of a particular stock, right? So if PE ratio is very high, that means investors are willing to pay a higher price. Obviously, if the ratio is high, it means numerator is going to be higher as compared to the denominator, right? So it shows investors are trusting in the growth potential of the company. They think that in future the earnings are going to be high, that is why they are willing to pay a higher price, right? So it can also mean that the company stock is overvalued, right? So P
PB ratio, PE ratio. They are quite similar in nature, but still there is difference. So I think we have discussed PE ratio in one previous session also in much detail if you want it, right? So you can ask for its link. Moving ahead, here you can see the formula, market price per share and the book value per share. As you can see, PB ratio measures market valuation relative to its book value. Market value of equity is typically higher than the book value of the company. So market value is usually higher. So guys, here we are trying to find book value per share, right? So I told you the formula. You have to divide it by number of shares to find out book value per share. PV ratio used by investors to identify potential investments. Because if this ratio is not very high, it means that the stock is undervalued and it's a good time to buy. As you can see here, under 1 are typically considered solid investment, but it can also mean that there is something fundamentally wrong with the company, right? So everything has, there are two sides of coin. Everything has good part as well as the bad part. So it is very important to research about the company. So obviously these are some indicators like PE ratio, PB ratio, but it is equally important to research about the company, to look into the financial statements of past years and the track record of company, right? So this is a comparison of PE and PB ratio. Moving ahead, so here is your second question for today. Okay, this question gives you some kind of case. Let's read it. It says, Mr. Rahul used to work with a company called Yashraj Technicals. After working there for 5 years, Rahul left the job to take up a position in a rival company called Dharma Consultancy Services, which was paying him better. Okay. But his previous employers are not happy with this decision and they are saying that Rahul has violated a clause in the employment agreement which he signed when he joined Yashraj. Which clause do you think is being talked about here? Right? So, a person took up a job in a rival company and his previous employers or ex-employers not happy with that decision. Now, they are saying that we are going to sue you and because you have violated a clause in an agreement which was signed when you joined us. Right? Let's see what is the answer for this question. And the answer for this question is option D. So, option D means non-compete clause, right? So this is a clause which is very famous in employment contracts basically. So I'm going to tell you briefly about it. So let's say there is a company A Limited. A Limited is in IT business. Now there is another company called B Limited. Now, A and B, they are rival firms, right? So, they both are in IT sector. So, let's say there is Mr. X and Mr. X, if he worked at A Limited, right? And after that, after a few years, he resigns from here and goes to B Limited, then obviously there are chances that this person can reveal some very important confidential information about A Limited to its rival B Limited. And also this company has spent so much time and cost on training this person. Obviously, whenever an employee joins an organization, the organization spends time and effort on that person to train them or to make them learn how the work is done, right? So, if this person goes to a rival firm and uses that expertise in another firm, obviously it is going to be loss for this company, right? So, that is why there are certain clauses in employment contract that if you are working with one company, then you have to sign a contract that you are not going to work with a rival company for a particular set of years. After that, you can, right? So, this is the situation here given in the question, right? Moving ahead. Okay, non-compete agreement. Contract wherein an employee promises not to compete with an employer in any way after the employment period is over. So, they give this clause gives power to the employer over certain actions of the former employee even after that relationship has ended. So that doesn't matter that the employee has left the job from the previous company or from the initial company, but still the employer has some sort of control over his life actions, over his decisions, because he cannot go to a rival firm. But guys, if the employee hasn't signed any contract, then there is no such compulsion because he's not legally bounded, right? So contract or legal existence of the relationship is very important. So these agreements prohibit employees from revealing proprietary information or secrets to other parties or rivals, especially rivals. Most contracts specify a certain length of time. So as I was telling you, there is a presence of a certain tenure of this non-compete clause. So if we go back to the example, so there can be, let's say there is a clause which says that Mr. Rahul cannot work with the rival company after 10 years of leaving Yashraj Technicals, right? So if he completes 10 years, let's say Rahul left Yashraj in 2014, then after 2024, he can go and work in a rival firm. So this period is mentioned because in that period, that employee loses touch with the previous company, right? And due to the time foregone, the amount of harm that the shift of employee can cause to the previous company is reduced, right? So that is why there is presence of some duration. So employers may require employees to sign these contracts before they keep their place in the market. So guys, this contract has recently been, this clause, non-compete clause, has recently been in news because very famous companies are involved in it. Yes, we are talking about the Future Group. So the Future Group, which belongs to Kishore Biyani, it is in news because of the defaults that they have made in their payments, right? So this is a company which is defaulter, right? Now they did a deal with Reliance. So as you know, Reliance is looking to enter the retail sector with JioMart. It has actually entered the sector with JioMart. So Future Group has decided to sell some of its assets to Reliance Group. So obviously Reliance is going to get some already established assets, some already established properties which it can use, and Future Group is going to raise some money to make their debt payments or to sell off the assets that they are not able to run properly. But there is one party which has problem with all this deal, and that party is Amazon. Now why has Amazon problem with this? Because they are saying that in 2019, this Future Group signed a deal with Amazon, or Amazon bought some stake in Future Group, and because of that, Amazon gets, and in that contract there was a non-compete clause due to which Amazon gets the right of first refusal. That means Amazon should be the one who will be offered the shares, or who will be offered the stake in this company, right? So this is the entire scene. That is why Amazon has problem with this deal going on between Future and retail. Now, Future and Reliance. So Reliance and Amazon, as we all know, competitors, because Amazon is already an e-tailer joint, where e-tailer giant, whereas Reliance is a new entrant here, but because of the popularity it has garnered, or because of the deals that it has done, it is already making some mark in this field, right? So here you can see some details. First of all, Future's deal with Amazon, which happened in 2019. Amazon agreed to invest 1500 crore in Future Coupons. So the company is called Future Coupons, which is the promoter company of Future Retail. So they are saying if Amazon is holding a 49% stake in a promoter company and a subsidiary is being sold, or if a company is being sold, they should be the first ones who should be offered, right? So non-compete clause curbs transfer to entities including RIL, that is Reliance, right? Future Group's Kishore Biyani enters into a deal with Amazon in August 2019. Now comes 2020, Futures deal with Reliance. Reliance Retail will buy Futures businesses including retail and logistics for around 24,700 crores. Future Group will merge some of the entities into Future Enterprises. RIL agrees to take on liabilities and debt of Future Group. So, do you see how both the parties, Future and Reliance, are benefited, but Amazon has created trouble in between, right? So, you can see here the statistics related to the Future Group. Its revenue from the FMCG business, from fashion business, and its debt, right? And its additional exposure to banks. So, I hope now you are clear with the story. Now, there is currently the talks are going on and they are looking for arbitration, but we'll update you whenever a new news comes up regarding this. Okay. So, here is your question number third for today, which says, just a second. Okay. Yes, the third question, it says Dash is a type of employee benefit plan which allows certain employees to take the benefit of stock ownership without actually giving them any company stock. So this talks about some sort of employee benefit program. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option for this question is option C. So option C means phantom stock. Now, what is the meaning of phantom stock? Before knowing the meaning of phantom stock, let us first understand what is meant by ESOPs or Employee Stock Ownership Plan. So guys, it is very simple. It is a benefit plan, or it is a mode, or it is a way to reward your employees by giving them some stake in ownership of the company, or by offering them some shares of the company, right? Gives workers ownership interest in the company, usually formed to allow employees the opportunity to buy stock in a closely held company to facilitate succession planning. So this is, see, obviously this is a remuneration method, and apart from that, it is also a motivation technique, because see, there are employees in the company, but if you are offering shares to them, that means the benefit they are getting on the shares is linked to the growth of company, right? So employees usually get fixed salary, but with this you are providing them some incentive to work harder for the growth of company. So obviously they know that if the company grows, the share price grows and the value of their investment grows, right? So this is also a way to motivate your employees to work more efficiently. So this is ESOP. Now coming to phantom stock. Now phantom stock plans, in this, the benefits of ESOPs are offered to employees, but without giving them the actual physical stock. That means they are provided with some incentives, they are provided with some rewards which are linked to growth of share price of company or growth of the company, but they are not being offered any shares, but they are being offered some incentives that are linked to the growth of the company. So if the company grows more, their incentive grows more. But see, they are not becoming owners of any stock of company, or they are not having any stake in the company. So employees receive mock stock, not the physical stock. Even though it's not real, phantom stock follows the price movement of the company's actual stock, paying out any resulting profits. So the resulting profits, so the profits are paid out to the employees who have invested in this, right? So this is phantom stock. Okay, two main types of phantom stock. First is known as appreciation only. So in this, the benefit that the employees are offered is related to the growth in the or rise in the price of share, but not the actual try to understand this with an example. So let's say when the employee bought the stock, the price was rupees 100. After some time, it became 150. So in appreciation only the rise is of 50 rupees. This 50 rupees is going to be paid to employee rather than the whole value of the share. But in full value, the entire value of the share, that is 150, will be paid to the employee, right? So appreciations do not include the value of actual underlying then shares, but may only pay out the value of any increase in company stock price over a period of time that begins on the date plan is granted. Full value pay both the value of the underlying stock as well as the appreciation. I hope now you are clear with ESOPs, phantom stock and the types of phantom stock, right? So guys, we are learning about it because recently there has been a trend going on which is known as ESOP buyback by companies. So it is also a motivational technique in which the companies, they buy back shares from employees at higher prices so that employees can have some gains. So if any employee wants money, they want to redeem their investment, they want to get rid of the shares of the company, they can sell them back to the company usually at a higher price than they are getting in market, right? So this is known as ESOP buyback. And recently a very famous company, a very famous edtech startup has come up with ESOP buyback, and that is Khan Academy. Right? Moving ahead. Okay. Here is the fourth question for today, which says, which of the following is or are not the types of CPI, consumer price inflation? Very simple question. Moving ahead to the correct answer, which is B. So B means 1 and 5 are not the types of CPI. So 1 is not, 5 is not, rest are the types of CPI. So guys, if you remember, we have discussed consumer price inflation in much detail and its comparison to WPI, that is the wholesale price index, in much detail in one of our previous session. If you want to watch that, you can ask for its link in the comments. Here you can see different types of CPI. First is CPI for the industrial workers, right? So in brief, what does CPI do? CPI is consumer price index. It is nothing but a measure of inflation. It measures that how much is the rise in the price of goods and services that a particular section of consumers buy at retail level, right? So they are calculated for different sections of the society. One is CPI for industrial workers, which calculated for workers. It calculates the price change in basket of goods and services used by industrial workers. So average working class family from any of these seven sectors in the economy, ranging from factories, mines, plantations and others. This is compiled by Labor Bureau. After that, CPI for agricultural laborers. So guys, what is going to be the difference in these is the composition of baskets of goods and services. So a person living in urban area might spend much of their money on technology related products, whereas a person living in rural area might spend much of their income on food or rent, right? So that is the difference. The composition of baskets of goods and prices of whom the prices are being measured is basically the difference in these indices, right? So agricultural laborers mask the prices, change in prices in the goods and services consumed by agricultural laborers. Same goes for CPI for rural laborers, also compiled by Labor Bureau. So this last one, CPI, urban non-manual employees, this was discontinued in 2008, right? Moving ahead. So recently there has been a news that industrial workers' salaries, they are going to see some increase, they are going to witness some increment, and government employees DA, dearness allowance. So dearness allowance is provided to employees in order to combat inflation. So obviously, if the inflation in economy is rising, the salaries of workers should also rise so that they can maintain their standard of living. So DA does that, protects them from the rise, protects them from inflation. I like DA is likely to increase with union government set to revise CPI for industrial workers. So the union government is going to make some changes into this into the calculation of CPI industrial workers. Base year is going to be revised from 2001 to 2016 to reflect the changing consumption patterns, which is likely to benefit millions of industrial workers, government employees and pensioners. So I hope you understand the base year is going to be changed. That means base year means on the basis of which year the prices are compared, right? So if you are marking the increase in price, there has to be some base against which you are comparing, right? So in the previous question, we were discussing that earlier the price was 100, it became 150, so the rise is 50. So there is some base in relation to which you are comparing the increase in price, right? So earlier the base year used to be 2001, it is going to be changed to 2016. And why is it done? So that the difference can be measured. So in the beginning of 2000s, people used to spend their income differently. Most of the money went on food or rent, but now much of the income that goes on technology or that goes on products like mobile phones or children's education, right? So the composition of spending has changed. To mark that or to reflect that, this is going to be changed, right? Okay, change in the base year will reflect the change consumption pattern of recent times, right? Moving ahead. So here is the last question for today, which says SEBI has recently brought up some regulations regarding disclosure of foreign audits. So guys, there is a correction. This is not foreign audits. This is forensic audits. Right? So disclosure of forensic audits. According to this, companies need not disclose the final report where the forensic audit has been initiated by this. So SEBI made some changes into the rules regarding disclosure of forensic audits, and according to this, companies need not disclose one fact in which of the case. That is your question. Moving ahead to the solution, and here is the solution which says that the correct option is A. So A means regulator or enforcement agencies. Now let us try to understand this whole thing. Guys, I hope you are aware of the meaning of the term forensic audit. We have discussed forensic audit in one of our previous sessions in much detail. So to give you a brief, a forensic audit is an audit which is conducted on a company to find some evidence against its wrongdoing. So if there is some doubt on a company that that company is involved in some malpractices, then the audit which is done to find some evidence which can be used in court, in courts, that audit is known as forensic audits. There is forensics team in investigation purposes which tries to find out minute details, right? So forensic audits discussed in previous session. Now SEBI has said that all the companies which are witnessing some forensic audits, they need to disclose it to the public that a forensic audit is being conducted on them, right? So disclosures to bourses, that is exchange, stock exchanges, on forensic audits, they need to disclose that fact, right? They will be required to disclose the initiation of forensic audit whenever the audit started. After that, name of the entity who has started such audit and reason for such start. And also, they have to make available the final forensic audit report to to stock exchanges with comments of the management, if any. So basically they have to tell the public, they have to tell to stock exchanges that who is conducting the forensic audit on them, why are they conducting such audit, and the date when it started, and after that the final report of audit. And if the company's management has made any comments on it, that also has to be submitted to stock exchanges. Companies need not disclose the final report where the audit has been initiated by. So this was your question, and the answer was regulator or enforcement agencies. So this question says that if this audit is being conducted by any regulator, let's say SEBI itself is conducting audit on a company, forensic audit on a company, then then they need not disclose the final report to the stock exchanges. So it is not compulsory in that case, right? So this move is being applauded because it is obviously going to increase transparency and tell shareholders and tell investors more about the companies they are about to invest in. But this is also seeing some criticism because many companies are saying that this is not right unless and until there is some sort of conformity that the company is involved in some wrongdoing. We should not tell public about it. That might create a bad image that an audit is going on, right? So unless and until the final verdict is out, we should not do this. That can result in erosion of shareholders' value for the company, right? Because investors are then going to be doubtful and skeptic. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video, and if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session with some new set of information. Until then, you take care of yourselves, keep your studies going on. I'll see you in the next session, and thank you for being here.